this movie is about several different things.
It's about an issue.
They try to mush together into something. Nightingale is also, I think, one of my problems with this movie is that it feels like a movie made by white people about Africa, whereas Nightingale feels like a movie that is understanding of the culture is different than what the director comes from and kind of allows it to flow through that.
It's about the director is from the same country that Nightingale takes place in, obviously, but she's not obviously an indigenous person.
Right. This movie to me, like the action scenes are too actiony. Like the way, especially the way that it's edited, with all of the like quick cuts and like the guy running down and like holding the RPG up and then yelling and shooting the RPG, and then it quick cuts behind him and it blows up and he jumps his hands up in the air and runs away. Like the thing about Nightingale is it really forces you to pay attention to the violence. And with only a couple of exceptions in this, the part where they kill the guy with the machete the a little bit of the scene where everybody gets executed in the town, this movie hides the violence behind sort of modern editing of action scenes.
I don't entirely agree with that.
I kind of do agree.
You get a little bit more of the consequences of violence than you do in action movies, but the actual violence itself happens mostly off screen, which also could be very much a budgetary thing. This movie was budgeted for $3 million. When they got to Ghana to shoot it, the line producer was like, they lied to us about what everything's going to cost. So they were basically like fighting for every dollar. They're making a $6 million movie for $3 million.
This movie costs $6 million. That's fucking amazing.
And either number would be amazing.
There were parts of this movie, 35 day shooting schedule too. 35 days. Whole darn movie.
Fukunaga, and almost everyone in this movie was cast off the street.
Right.
despite the low budget, I feel like this movie suffers a little from being too slick.
That's what I'm saying.
It's too pretty, it's too shot, gorgeous. and the score kind of takes you a step away from it and makes it into sort of this ethereal experience
Stop. You said it's too pretty. What do you mean?
I mean that the production.
He's talking about the cinematography itself.
The production values make it a little bit too packaged. For me, in a way,
this was the first movie he ever shot digitally. He shot
it himself, by the way.
Because the DP got hurt on the first shot they did.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think that this film is trying for a visual beauty.
I don't think so either. It is on a certain level, but I also think
films have to have a certain level of you have to get to a certain level. So
About the scene where they color grade it and all the trees turn red for that scene?
He's tripping on drugs for the first time.
No, that's it. First of all, A and B, that's a tribute to a war photographer from the 70s who shot a lot of stuff on infrared film.
Who filmed using expired Kodak infrared film.
Yeah.
It's also the first time he's on Brown.
Yeah, that's the thing. Everything's kind of, and also the greens turn red, and everything's kind of not real. That was beautifully expressed.
But there's this too, and this looks like something out of Congo. Like this literally looks like a Michael Crichton.
$50 million
Michael Crichton.
When you look at that background,
but also it could also be Apocalypse Now.
It's funny because when I'm looking at
which is also an art film about war,
right? Yeah, there are strong similarities all over for Apocalypse Now in this thing.
Something I didn't like, especially when they get to the end and they do the whole like basically going back in time thing. Like they're almost traveling back to pre-colonial civilization with the way that it's shot and the mist and all of that other stuff. Like they do that kind of, we've gone far enough up the river that we're now in prehistory.
Oh, you're talking about Apocalypse Now. Now,
well, and but in but in the no, book, I'm saying in this movie, like they do that as they get towards the end. It gets more dreamlike and it gets more.
They're driven further and further into the bush for one thing.
The
background.
They lose their sugar.
Background. There's a scenic, so they'll stop and they'll show like the scenery, the you know the hillsides and the verdant, the green like that. What you're looking at in some ways, and this is what I saw, is I'm looking at these like how they really fucked this place up. I mean, that everything is showing evidence of previous clear cutting. I mean, every ground they cover is disturbed. You know what I mean? It's all weeds growing out of places where there should be forest. I mean, that's what I kept seeing over and over again.
They did
a number on Ghana, wherever this is where they shot it. They did a real number on that place.
I kept
Ghana never had a civil war. Like that's one of the things about
They have a civil war, but they actually went and they cut all the fucking tree down, man. You could definitely tell.
But there are forest scenes. How could you tell that was
a few, but yeah. Most of the places you can see they've actually ravaged the countryside.
Yeah. I kept thinking of Come and See while I was watching this film.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Very similar to that, my God. Well, mm-hmm. I think it's a buildings Roman. You know, like I said, it's like a story about some person going through a personal change and coming to a place of like, you know.
Well, and even though this is sort of an amalgamation of different things in Africa, this is very much real in terms of what people go through. Mm-hmm. And I mean, it was fucking brutal. And
I thought it was very plausible, you know, in terms of it's like when we got to the scene 22 minutes in when they got everybody on their knees and you know what's about to go down. And then the crazy lady totally sells them. He throws them under the bus. Yeah. I don't know these guys.
Damn,
they're not from this town. That's just like, oh, your stomach just sinks and you know what's happening. But you also know it's like, okay, I know what's going to happen right now, but this is how you make a child soldier.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to back up.
How about when his brother gets shot as they're running? That's so fucked up.
It's like that whole part was stuff. That wasn't actually his mom. It's just somebody who looked like his mom, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it wasn't his mom.
Okay. I'm not sure. I don't know.
I watched the director's commentary when I was going back looking for screenshots from this, and the director's commentary seems to imply it was his mom.
Yeesh. But it didn't look like the same actress at all.
Well, a lot happened to her, I guess.
She's sure. listed as mother in the credits. So,
all right.
Wow.
But he says that, several times
that fucking scene. Oh
in which God. Case, spoiler alert, he shoots his mom in the head.
Yeah. He says several times
while she's being
raped.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
He says several times in the commentary that you're not necessarily to take anything that you see on screen at face value. So, like,
unreliable narrator.
Well, you got to give it up for Netflix to make this their first feature.
Yeah.
I think this also we haven't mentioned it yet, but I think this is probably the best performance by Idris Elba ever.
Oh,
Idris Elba is a fucking incredible actor. Uh-huh. And like,
I mean, he just needs to go there. He's good in everything, but this is particularly not. I mean, I wouldn't, based on all the other shit that he does, which is all phenomenal, you wouldn't necessarily think he would do this kind of role, and he fucking does it with.
He's like, great in Hobbs and Shaw. Shut up.
Like, no, I mean, he really, the accent. It's on the level of a standard. Like, his accent in this is so fucking authentic and
really
good.
Solid.
So the part where he's singing and dancing, he didn't know he was going to do that until like the day of, and he didn't want to do it. And basically the director pulled him aside and was like, no, you can do this. Like, you got this.
Well,
like,
and how, you know, people who act know this. And I think obviously filmmakers know this, but like to write a villain that is as charming and complex as this and to perform, to be able to execute that as an actor. Like, I mean, I just, the biggest kudos to him for making this a real complex person who is charming and captivating, yet definitely evil as fuck.
And in his mind, he's not a villain.
That's what makes the best villains. In their mind, they're not.
In the end, he's helpless too. He's completely without power at all.
Yeah. Yeah, that actually was one of my favorite parts of the movie. Is when he finally gets to what's the big guy's name?
The Supreme Commander.
Supreme Commander, and it becomes this bureaucratic sort of nightmare where he's just in a waiting room for about 24 hours. Uh-huh.
That's messed up.
it was like the waiting room in The Hunger.
I think Tad nibbled at this, but I'm going to finish off this idea that one of the objections I had to the film after watching it, and again, I thought it was really effective film and very emotionally honest and right in your face, was that was bleached. This was run through a Hollywood filter. There wasn't a single national flag in this film. There was no recognizable politics.
It was all crazy, except
for the UN and Nigeria. It's all made up shit.
Yes, right. but that took the power away from me because it's like,
this is all made up. You know, they're trying not to offend.
Made a movie. It was a fictitious country, right?
They're combining things that happened in the Uganda. Ivory Coast.
Yeah.
The Ivory Coast and
like Rwanda.
Liberia and
the Liberian Civil War.
I'm not going to say you guys are wrong, but I think that where it did shine was in its. It didn't hold back on the brutality.
And no, it did not.
That really spoke to me in terms of the execution. So, yes, it's a little polished, but they really didn't pull any punches in terms of the subject matter and how they depicted it. So that, to me, sort of overrode the slickness of it.
Yeah.
You guys haven't brought this up yet. I mean, it's all to say, on one hand, it's a very good looking movie, and I wonder if that's literally because Fukunaga is so talented. He is very talented.
That's probably part of it.
The fact that he made a movie that looked like this on $3 or $6 million is kind of blowing my mind a little bit.
Sure.
But
this is another thing he says.
It looks like $150,000.
$150 million. This looks like a $100 million movie without
or $100 million. I mean,
but yeah. another thing he says in the commentary is they're shooting on Alexas and they have really good lenses. They track down some fucking choice lenses for this. So he's trying to shoot it like it's a film in digital, and then trying to color time it like it's a film in digital too. Yeah.
I think he got really close. Whether
or not it looks too slick, or whether or not it's whitewashed or the violence is sanitized or whatever. At its core, and no one said this yet, it is about this little boy and what this little boy goes through from start to finish. And the movie for me was made off of the performance of that kid and his friends.
Damn, yes.
Absolutely. That really, yes, you guys are making some points that I don't necessarily disagree with, but it didn't change my feeling about watching this kid and what he went through, and the raw emotion of that little boy and his buddy, was really striker.
I agree with Chris. Maybe it's because I'm a bit sad right now. Maybe it's because I'm a father, but I'm with you, Chris. Like, this movie affected me. Mm-hmm. It really did.
Well, that's what I meant earlier when I talked about just being a buildings Roman. That's what it is. It's about one person and their changes as they go through a portion of their life. And that's
my son is the same age as that kid.
I know. And the thing is, as a buildings Roman, this film is without reproach because it really, it's right. And it's inches from his face the entire movie. It's amazing. Yeah.
I did say to somebody else that this was whiplash for child soldiers, and I stand by that.
Man, that's messed up.
But I do.
May the devil lick your asshole in hell for all eternity.
There you go. Where's the clip?
That might be the clip. That's the craziest analogy I've ever heard in my life.
Am I wrong?
Yes, you're fucking wrong.
Not necessarily wrong.
Well, I also appreciate the fact that the movie gave us at least 15, 20 minutes at the beginning just to kind of show this kid's world. This whole thing with the TV.
And then the UN guy who captures them at the end is the same one who bought the TV from them.
I did not catch that.
He was the Echo Mod soldier who was there at the checkpoint who they sold the TV to, and then he ends up with the UN.
I appreciate the fact.
I love the relationship with him and his brother. That's why I was so upset when his brother died.
But. Like it actually
he wraps him up in the carpet.
I love the flashlight trick. He's all, turn your flashlight off. Now turn it on.
Right? That was great. That was a great scene.
These kids might have been scraping the poverty level, but by the standards that they're used to, like they seemed like they were doing okay.
They were
like,
doing okay. They had TV. Come on. It's like, it was great.
Well, he says we're fine in the
dad was a teacher. Yeah.
Yeah. Like we're in the buffer zone. The war is on both sides of us and we're fine. And then just
watching the little cues that it was creeping in.
Yeah, with the night scene where you start seeing the explosions in the background. And it's like, well, they're fucked.
No, when the power went out, you knew that that's the end.
Yeah, that's it.
Like they're screwed. You know, the power goes out, you're just
I feel like the first third of the movie and the last third of the movie are the strongest, and the middle, which is all the violence and all the trauma and stuff, it's like I get it and I'm there for it, but I have critiques for that. But
it was hard to watch.
It's hard to watch, but not only that, I have critiques for it. But nevertheless, the kid's great. The directing is great. Everything you guys said about it is true. And when you get to the end, I think I really felt it when he was in the orphanage.
Yeah.
And he had the talk with the girl, the young woman who was trying to get him to come out of his shell. And
that was a mission, actually.
Tell me your story. Was it an orphanage or a mission?
It was a mission. Yeah,
it was a mission. Christian
mission. Well,
she's a therapist, though. She's not a
oh, yeah, no, she's not. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that fucking A, man. I mean, I can't even, I'm getting a little choked up. That speech that he made to her.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Holy shit.
Oh, yeah. You would be dead if you saw what he saw. You'd be self-aware too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
And the movie didn't really tie things up. I mean, like you don't really. Is he going to be okay?
Nope.
I don't.
And I love that too. It's just
actually, there's a bit of hope. He goes and plays.
He joins the other kids.
Yeah.
For the first time, he joins the other kids.
Baby steps, man. Baby steps. You show that Randy ran off and went back into the fight again, which isn't good.
I mean, it's sort of like the end of the 400 Blows, actually.
A little bit.
Several of the people who were in this movie were child soldiers.
This kid.
Wow.
A tripod. The guy who's naked through the whole thing.
Striker, the guy who's naked through the whole thing.
He was an actual child soldier in Sierra Leone.
And he's a show off.
Thanks. Well, you know,
and also he insisted on being naked, which is weird, you know.
But one of the things from the Liberian Civil War is a lot of people were naked. Famously, there's a General Butt Naked who
that's
was.
His nickname?
Yes.
General
Butt Naked. Look up General Butt Naked.
I will.
He literally is one of the craziest characters in the history of the world. Like this dude, he was a priest and he got involved in the Liberian Civil War and committed a bunch of war crimes, and he's still alive, and it's fucking wild.
And you're saying he did it all naked?
Yes, he would go. Sometimes he would wear like pumps and like a shawl, but he would go fucking just bare ass naked. So all of those little
patches, no shirt, no shoes, no service does not mean
all those little patches that
not in West Africa, no,
all over their shit.
Yeah,
those are Muslim prayer cards that are wrapped up in little things that are sold to them by locals, and it makes them think that they're immune to bullets. That's why they have the scene where they all point the guns at them and shoot, and they have the blanks in them.
Right, it's to prove
that doesn't kill you.
Yeah.
There's a witchcraft thing too. It's like charm.
The guy who's got the big staff, that staff is actually designed to prevent you from getting hit by rockets.
Right.
Like,
it would have been cool if they would have went into some of that stuff.
No, it's, I
mean, yes, that's again,
it's in there, like, but you'd have to know it.
If they'd made it a true, like, not a true story, but based on one specific conflict, I think they could have gone better.
In addition to come and see me
playing Joseph Coney.
I forgot about that.
That's a big thing after.
No, the Supreme Commander would be more like Coney.
In addition to come and see me, though, I also thought of that film that Jim had us watch where it was just the interview of that guy, the black
man. Oh, yeah.
Oh, very much. Well, that's
the Laughing Man.
Laughing Man. So I thought of the Laughing Man a lot during this, obviously, because of the subject matter.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Yeah, you don't get to see the CIA directly involved here, but all of a sudden there's helicopters flying overhead. Yeah,
dropping bombs.
Like, hmm.
But just, I mean, literally the dead bodies on the side of the road were straight out of The Laughing Man.
Yeah. You know, it's I think it's interesting that you guys like, well, it's a little too pretty, you know, in terms of like the way the cinematography works, because it's in, you know, it was shot anamorphically. Of course, yeah. It's they use really nice Baltar and
I have to buy another. I think that calls horn. For the air horn.
I have to buy another air horn. Thing anamorphic.
Is, when you do anamorphic, you can't help make it look pretty. That's just how it works. Just,
especially if it's a funeral.
If they wanted to be ugly, they would have shot. They would have shot square with like, you know. And also, there was almost no handheld shots in this whole movie. Notice that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Fukunaga, so, man.
No, it's very. Oh, it's very. It is very polished, but I think that. Obviously,
oh boy, from Sebastopol.
Obviously, he wanted to do that on purpose.
So. Yeah, well, he wanted a good looking.
This
movie.
Is his film. This is
Anna
his film.
To Italy.
It's also wild.
Went to
it's Italy, also wild huh? that
you
that
went to Italy.
Wow. It's also wild that he's the director of the new James Bond. Like this is not the trajectory I would have thought that ends with you doing a James Bond movie.
Well, wasn't he half of
True Detective, season one.
Yeah, well, the lady that made the trailer trash movie that won all the Oscars got to make a Marvel superhero movie next. So also, that's the way the trajectory goes, right?
No one's complaining about how the True Detective looked. That was
True Detective looked great.
Yeah.
One of the reasons I picked this movie was because I thought he did a good job in the Bond movie.
Okay. Right.
But I also been wanting to watch it for 5 years.
We need Jim's Corner.
Jim's Corner.
So, Jared mentioned The Laughing Man, which is one of the things I thought of. I thought, of course, of Come and See. But I also thought of the first third of Kubrick's Full Metal Jacket.
A bit.
They do a lot in this movie, which I hadn't seen in other sort of child soldier movies, which is how they sort of indoctrinate them and, you know, just all the little rituals they're doing with their
when they're teaching them to cover their zones.
He's got like a stick.
Yeah.
And then they beat them as they run by.
Well, they did. Yeah. They run the gauntlet.
It's very.
Well, you know what's cool about that scene was they beat them as they run through, right? That one guy fell.
Doesn't make it.
So what did they do to him?
Killed him.
Right.
Yeah. They slit his throat immediately after because he went down.
There's real consequences for everything.
It's like Starship Troopers when the guy stands up and gets shot in the head. Like,
that's right.
If you fail that type of test, you're done. That was during basic training, right?
Yeah. Also, bringing up Come and See, compare and contrast the imperatives of these films. It's like, it seemed like the kid in this was just being recruited by some just freaking warlord to go out and just shoot somebody who just they didn't agree with or just take over property and territory. Come and See, though, there was necessity to it. That kid joined for a reason, and the people he was up against were genuinely evil. And then
I think they're both traumatized in the end.
Oh no, traumatized.
And I think there's a parallel. And
Travis Bickle was traumatized by Vietnam.
And there's there's a parallel between the kid in Come and See and the kid in this one, where it ages you inappropriately. And like even though in Come and See, which was it's a brilliant film. I'm so happy we watched that, even though it's so brutal.
I know it really rubbed off.
But they actually age him with makeup, like we can see
gray in his hair and things like that.
Right. And in this one they didn't do that, but I still felt like this kid had that weight of the world on his shoulders at the end of this picture.
Well, when they're in the
he doesn't seem like a kid anymore at the end.
When they're in the brothel and he looks over at that girl after they've had the couple of beers and he smiles. And he does that little eye wiggle at her and stuff like that. Like that's not what a 12-year-old does. Like he is definitely aged significantly by the end of this.
Yeah.
It's brutal picture.
Yeah.
I thought it was superb.
Yeah, literally never going to watch this again.
Acknowledging everything.
No shit.
It was hard, man.
Ever want to watch this again, but I think it's Idris's best performance. I think this kid is amazing.
I want to say something about the sound design is fucking great, and I'll bet it was even better, you know, if I'd had 5.1, but
I did it with headphones, and it is really good.
Yeah, I did it with headphones too. It's really good. Yeah.
The stuff they do where bullets are being fired from far away.
Yeah, and they do, and they go around. Yes.
So you don't hear the report of the gun so much as you just hear the bullet, and then pop, it hits something.
They sound like insects. Yeah, they sound like bugs.
It's going terrifying.
That's the scene where the kid's walking and he keeps looking. You know, it's like, what the fuck was?
And right
it
before
does
they
sound like it starts over here and then it ends over here and it just sounds like a whip being cracked.
Right,
or it's,
right,
yeah.
It's and right amazing. Before they, right before they take the bridge, there's a big scene where we're gonna take the bridge, and they're just standing. They're all fucking standing there, and so I'm feeling like they should be laying on the ground at that point because it's so hot. And a bullet just kind of hits a wall right behind their heads.
Oh yeah, yeah.
That was intense.
There's the scene where a bullet hits him, or like a ricochet hits him, but
It doesn't hit him. It hits nearby, and he looks down on the ground, and there's the shell.
And he sees it, and he goes to pick it up, and that's when the bullet
and it goes
hits
over his head.
It gives you a terrible feeling of insecurity.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's a similar thing where unfortunately where Stryka gets actually hit, and we don't know it at first.
Yeah,
but he looks. We see him look at it, and then later, of course, it's revealed that he's
just got a little hole.
The reveal was terrible because it looked like, let's go. And he didn't want to go. I thought he was being stubborn.
Yeah.
I don't want to leave. And then you saw later on he can't actually move because he's been shot. I was like, oh
God.
And Stryker was the commander's catamite before, right?
That's why he said, these two are with me.
That's why he comforts him afterwards.
I mean, that's what our
and he does, when he comes out.
Yeah, our protagonist also gets raped by him, do I?
Yeah.
No, he absolutely does.
Okay.
And Idris brutal. Elba did not want to do that.
I imagine
he did
not
want to do that scene. And he had to be talked into, the director had to be talked into it too by the author of the novel.
Wow.
No, I couldn't believe they did that. And obviously they did it very sort of
off screen.
Yeah, like not
Sheila saw it coming before
but they
I
didn't
did.
Do it for the mother.
I want to say tastefully, even though you can't even apply that word, but they didn't do it in
it
a
wasn't
brutal
purient.
Way.
It wasn't
no, it was not. It was absolutely not purient. And the way Idris Elba plays that scene where he's sitting in the room and he says, you're going to...
And then he lays down on the bed.
You're going to keep secrets.
He reaches his arm out.
Is lay down on the bed and you know exactly where we're going.
Yeah.
And then they cut, thank God.
Yeah. Well,
they don't cut entirely.
Well, they cut, but then you see Agu walking out, and you just know.
Yeah,
he's fucked up. Yeah,
well, the way also, he's walking.
But also, they don't cut all the way because you're behind the cage and you're pointed at the two crates stacked on top of each other, and there's still audio in the background. And then it cuts to him walking.
But then you also see that's the first time Stryka really consoled Agu.
Right.
Because he was the one before.
Right, because he's been there. As well,
which is why he doesn't speak.
Right, it's why he doesn't speak. That's right.
I will say one thing that did bother me. This happens two or three times in the movie. They would have taken Stryker's boots when he died. They absolutely would have taken his boots.
We say they didn't do it. They didn't do the pockets. Take the boots. Take the gun.
They would have done the pockets.
Yeah. No.
Okay. If we're gonna pick nets,
look like they took his gun.
Did they?
You can't tell,
but I almost cried when it was brutal with the palms on him.
So that's another thing. The actors improvised that.
It was beautiful.
They were literally
had a shot before they walked away. They laid him on there, but then they had another shot of just the palms on the ground.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and I thought that was beautiful.
Yeah, there's a lot of ashes to ashes, dust to dust in this movie.
Yeah, I'll say.
I was going to bring up something that I think for me was for critiquing purposes, the weakest part of the film is that scene I brought up before where he says, we're going to take the bridge. And he's sort of revving up all the soldiers, the child soldiers to go do this assault on this town. And the whole point is we're going to take this town, we're going to go across this bridge, and we're going to kill everybody. You never saw anyone shooting back. I felt like there was, maybe it was the budgetary thing, but
that's where that bullet we just talked about that moment.
Right before that, right? That's right before that scene, because they're standing there getting ready to go across the bridge.
And it shoots right by him, and he bends down to pick up, and then
and it hits the wall. Yeah. That all I liked. But then when they went in, it was just a series of shots of them shooting guns and coming forward and running into the town and going over the bridge, yeah, and all that. And you never once saw the targets.
I think that's probably budgetary.
I agree. It didn't work for me as a sequence.
You saw people dying and getting shot.
Play
that part again, Jared. You don't see any targets being hit.
It's just like a montage of them shooting. Okay.
I agree with John. This is, that part was kind of like, it was a visual. What happened is the visual geography broke down.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's what happened. It's like they did not have an idea about how this is supposed to look, and it was just chaotic.
Which
is not part of the whole movie. The whole movie was actually very logical looking.
I'm pretty sure that the bridge and the town were in very different places too.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So that's another problem of like
learning about the budget. I agree. I think
I just assumed that the bridge was right outside of the town. It didn't take me out enough to like, I was like,
no,
I
in the story, it absolutely is. I just think in the real world, it.
Right.
It wasn't. Yeah.
They shot one of them. They shot one of them over here, and they shot one of them over there.
Why the hell is that?
Did somebody's recycling fall over?
All you guys' critiques are great. I appreciated the fact that this movie got made at all.
Why'd you pick it?
This is a story that doesn't get told.
Oh yeah, why'd you see it?
Why'd you pick it?
Because again, like this is at the time that it came out. I think Idris even might have got nominated for an Oscar.
I think he did.
Oh, yes, he did. This was not nominated for Oscars because it came out on streaming at the same time.
Back then they were anti.
The Academy hadn't changed the rules yet.
Him and the kid got independent spirit, right?
And BAFTA.
There was a lot of, and I remember reading the synopsis going, oh man, that's going to be rough. And Sandy, my wife, was like, no fucking way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
she loves Idris. She was no way going to watch this.
Well, he should have been nominated.
Sort of sitting there like this, I know I got to get to that because it's probably going to be great. Mm-hmm. And here we go.
And Netflix didn't break out until Roma. Actually, if you remember, that was the one that really brought him.
That's when they changed the rules.
Yeah, right. Yeah, but that film,
Chris, Sheila and I were watching it Saturday night, and it got, like I said, to that 22-minute point where they've got everybody in the village on their knees. And you know what's about to happen. And she's like, I can't.
Yeah.
We turned it off and we watched it again. We finished watching it this morning.
Oh, I almost stopped it a few times,
Wait, haven't you seen this already, Jared?
No,
Have none of you guys seen this?
No.
Oh,
that's why you picked it. Cause none of us had seen it.
No, I thought Jared had seen it.
No.
Oh. No,
he's the kind of guy who would have saw in the festival, but no, he did not see it.
No. You know what I realized? It's one of those ones that I had started it, but I hadn't got. Yeah, I realized that when I started again, but for whatever reason I didn't make it far enough to even be like, oh, I can't watch. Or you know, it was just one of those things where like I got interrupted and then I never went back to it.
Also, can I say it's weird as fuck to have something start with a Criterion logo and then go into a Netflix logo?
Yeah,
that was odd.
Like I know there's been like four or five of them at this point.
That's the version you watch, Tad.
Right, but no, but I'm saying it's really weird.
Well, it's a very, very recent Criterion edition.
Criterion's now selling. Sorry, Netflix is selling their movies to Criterion because they've done Roma, The Irishman, and this.
There's two more. I think there's five total. But yeah, it's just really strange still to be like. Normally, you see the Criterion logo, then it's like Janus Films, every so often you see the Criterion logo, and it's like Universal, and it's like the Criterion logo into Netflix is still fucking.
It's pretty odd.
It's hilarious.
So did you watch it on a Criterion channel? Is that why you saw that?
Sure, I did.
Every time I mentioned the Janus Films thing, I always remember that those guys made their bones distributing 16mm films to
they kept
the shutter weave in there because
and it's still that. And it's still the proof of quality. If you see the Janus totally Films is. Logo,
you know it's good. You know it's right. good.
A thumbs,
dude. Man, I'm so like. Like I could go either way on this. Uh-huh. Like
I don't want to see it again, but absolutely.
I'll second that, Jared.
it ranks with Come and See on that level.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I still
I think this is an important
I still movie. Like the Nightingale better.